So that election happened. 5 days of patient and not so patient waiting have yielded Joe Biden and Kamala Harris as the president-elect and vice president-elect of the United States. The celebrations you've seen around the country, from just outside the White House to Brooklyn to Harlem and Times Square to Atlanta to Philly. The incredible video memes likening the epic finish to the climax of the Avengers Endgame, or the demise of the Wicked Witch in The Wiz, or the Oh Happy Day moment in Sister Act, all spoke to the profound belief of tens of millions of Americans who understand just how close, I mean, the relief they have, because they understand just how close we came to losing our democracy. Those who reference the jubilation at the fall of the Berlin Wall or the street celebrations when a dictator is overthrown were backed up by historians like Michael Beschloss and journalists like Richard Engel, because that's how close we came. In just over 70 days, the Trump era will end as abruptly as it began. And whether or not Trump eventually concedes, at noon on January 20th, the Constitution will do it for him. And he will leave the White House, willingly or not, but he will go. And with him will exit some of the greatest villains in American political history. William Barr, the worst attorney general since, well, his predecessor, Jefferson Sessions, who was the worst attorney general since Richard Nixon's criminal AG, John Mitchell. And Stephen Miller, sadly, only one of multiple white nationalists who Trump brought into the administration to tragic results for Muslim and migrant families and refugees. They will all go, taking the lying press secretaries and incompetent national security and health and State Department appointees with them, and America can breathe again. Finally, someone in government will try to reunite those hundreds of migrant children with their parents. That executive order banning federal funding to institutions that tell the truth about America's racial history, which could have slashed funding to public schools and historically black colleges, that will be gone. More than 700,000 DACA recipients will no longer have to fear deportation. We'll rejoin the Paris Climate Accords and the World Health Organization and the global search for a coronavirus vaccine and exit the axis of autocracies. We can repair our relationships with our allies who will no longer think that we are a nation gone mad. And we can work on police reform and restoring the Voting Rights Act. And instead of potentially millions of us dying in a bizarre herd immunity experiment, we'll finally have a plan to defeat the coronavirus with a strategy based on science, not miracle cures and quacks and pillow salesmen. 74 million voters and counting literally saved the lives of millions of Americans by firing Donald Trump. That's why we call you voting MVPs. That is why people are dancing. We owe tremendous thanks to the voters, particularly black voters who held it down, and the activists who got it done. Stacey Abrams, whose organization registered 700,000 Georgians, and Latasha Brown, and the ladies from Black Girls Vote, and the Black Lives Matter activists, and Voto Latino, and the wine moms who organized their neighbors, the Latino and indigenous voters who showed up in Arizona, and of course, to the steady-as-she-goes Biden campaign. Thank you. Joe Biden will become just the second Catholic American president. And parents can finally once again tell their kids that the president of the United States is a good and decent man. Kamala Harris will become the first black, first woman, first Asian American, and also the first HBCU graduate and member of a black sorority to be vice president. And little girls of every race, color, and creed will see themselves when they see American power. There's been a lot of talk about what Biden voters owe the 70 million people who voted for Donald Trump. Honestly, I'm old enough to remember what they felt they owed Hillary Clinton voters in 2016. The phrase, F your feelings, comes to mind. It's not our job to make them feel better. I personally am not ready to have people in my life who were okay with racism, neo-Nazism, and mass death and child snatching at the border. But go off, Katy Perry. And the good news is, none of that matters. It is not my job to manage MAGA emotions. I just talk on TV. Joe Biden is going to be the president, and he has made it clear that he intends to be actively the president for everyone. And that's a good thing. It's a necessary thing, because we've got a vicious virus to fight, every one of us, so that we can get back to our normal lives and out of our basements. And the right can go back to hating us because we've got Hollywood and Beyonce. Sorry. In his 1865 inaugural address, delivered just a month before his death, Abraham Lincoln offered a broken country both a warning and a hope. The warning, that the 600,000 dead in the still unfinished Civil War were nothing short of the judgment of God for the flagrant sin of slavery. But he ended that speech pleading with America to end the war with malice toward none, with charity for all, with firmness in the right as God gives us to see the right. Let us strive on to finish the work we are in, to bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him who shall have borne the battle and for his widow and his orphan, to do all which may achieve and cherish a just and a lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations. Here's rooting for you, President-elect Biden. You're going to need it, but good luck.